Next speaker is Greg Shore from Premier Geophysics. So he'll be speaking today about an overview scale 3D resistivity imaging for the indirect location of deep feeder structures in hot spring epithermal gold sands.
We've been collecting 3D resistivity and IP data since 1982. And over the years, we've come to recognize certain features in the data sets that have been useful for one thing or another. We're still getting surprises every now and then. And one of those was a couple of years ago, I guess, we were doing some data from New Zealand where we were mapping in large fossil geothermal regimes, things that are 7, 8, 9 miles across, looking for silicic structures, gold bearing structures. And some of the perspectives we were getting and looking at the data were suggestive of the upper parts of a hydrologic system that would make a lot of sense in terms of explaining what we're seeing at the surface and giving us some possible insights as to what might be happening deep below, even below the depth range of our data sampling. So this is about that concept and how it kind of spread through some other data sets. It's not a discovery case history by any means, but it's meant to stimulate consideration of what you might be able to find when you have data sets of the type that E-Scan, Orion, NUDAS, the really high density, uniformly distributed sampling technologies are providing. When you've got the sort of objectivity that, that comes from this intensity of sampling, you're able to pay attention to subtleties, nuances that otherwise might be buried in the noise or considered as artifacts of processing of a much sparser data set. So that's where we're going to go with this, and I'll remind you a couple of times, I guess, about the importance of the hard data in covering some of these conclusions. This is a site in New Zealand where we've got situations with grassy hills like here, back in the distance, this one here. These are all sinter deposits, seemingly disconnected. And where we're going to go with this is hopefully an idea that allows visualization of the location of the plumbing responsible for these particular features so that you might be able to get a drill into it and possibly encounter the demands of great values. So get on there. This is basically the story. Epithermal systems are pretty tall. You can do a lot with the first few hundred meters. As you get deeper, the target area of interest gets smaller, which is the exact opposite of what you'd like to have in terms of electrical geophysics. The deeper you go, the bigger the anomaly needs to be, or the stronger in order to still see it from surface. So that's the challenge when you're dealing with epithermal gold. We're talking about big picture mapping here, so we need big data, broad, deep, and so on. Okay, I'm getting the hang of this here. This is an example of a 10 meter dipole survey that was being run in the Tutagon district of British Columbia, looking for 2 meter wide quartz vein structures, basically scaling the survey to the exact form dome of the target structure. 10 years of doing that by a number of majors resulted in zero discoveries, and it was a pretty discouraging area. We came into the area and decided, well, these quartz structures, silicon structures, when they're in the process of being precipitated and carrying fluids, conduits, they're leaking all over the place, and typically we can expect to see a halo, an envelope of alteration. Why don't we step back and see if we can see those at least, and then narrow down the area that we want to look in more detail. So this is pseudo-section data, and this is the scale of the measurements that we used with E-scan in the area where this scale was clearly not successful. So it's a big jump from 60 meters of nominal sampling to 600 meters. And this is what resulted in that area. We're talking about the alteration halo. This is a 100 meter radius around a structurally controlled quartz below the Perry's gold. So in the past, people were trying to find that, and our suggestion was that we maybe could be looking for something of this size. It was initially proven up off the map here, a couple of miles over, where the producing lawyers deposit was first mapped at this scale. We're talking about 100 meter grid stations here, the black dots. We saw the same thing around the producing deposit a couple of miles away. So, long story short, you can see that you've got zones like this that look just like that, but you've also got connecting patterns. If your data set is dense enough, you have confidence that that's not an artifact or an extrapolation or an interpolation, but that's a real measurement. So you can get busy and actually spend some money drilling these things. This one, corresponding with the regional fault trends, was a first choice to drill, and the result was a 60 meter long, 2 meter wide shear that was producing intersections of more than 75 ounces per ton. It was mined out. It was just tremendously rich. So, but that's not the end of the scaling that needs to be done in some cases. Here's the scale jump from the tiny to the 600 meter, and now we're looking at E-scan covering about 50 or 60 square kilometers of valley bottom, and we're talking now in terms of inverted section, not pseudo-section. So when we look at this 2,500 meter tall slice through the inverted 3D model, we're talking about something that was generated from data that ran from near surface to in excess of 4 kilometers below surface. And that's all DC resistivity. That's not a bit of DC resistivity. And then MT, that's a continuous sampling depth of DC resistivity. So in this case, the point we want to make here is that if you're going to have something, a model like this, and this is actually an important component of it, you want to make sure that your data, your measured data, didn't cut off right here, in which case this can just be an effect of the processing and unconstrained convenience, basically, on the part of the inversion. If we have data in great density down to this sort of a depth, we do the full height model and then do the full height model and then cut it off well above the level at which we can verify that we have full data constraint. But the white line that's often put on this these models to indicate where the limit of confidence is. So that's an entire geothermal system, and of course we would expect all sorts of little areas of upwelling and hot spring deposition and so on. So we can go from very tiny to extremely large, all with the same hardware system. And we saw a pretty small application of this at Comstock just a couple of minutes ago, the 25 meter space. Talking about the vertical side of things, we saw the benefits of expanding laterally in the Tunagon, where we were able to map the alteration envelope. Here we're looking at something at depth. In this case, Echo Bay's K2 deposit up at Republic, they had run some DC resistivity in EM across the ore body here, looking for a signature that they could use for regional exploration purposes. And they weren't getting any results. They had results, but it wasn't showing anything, no anomaly. So they brought E-scan in to see if it was sort of, you know, what was going on. And, we ran it, and here's a look at a plane through the 3D model, which goes right through the ore body. And we see very little differentiation laterally here. It appears that this system, which was originally fractured up and then flooded with hydrothermal fluids, silica precipitated, gold, sealed back up, healed, by pure bad luck, ended up being 300 to 400 ohm meters. Which is about the same as the original unfractured volcanic host. So, you know, what are the odds? But it does happen. So we verified that the original geophysics was fine, and we just can't see this, and it's just the way it worked out. But while we were there, talking about getting this overview, our data set was run basically on a why not basis. Orion and UDAS surveys with the array already in place, you're measuring to the maximum depth that's available from the layer automatically. It's there, so it's not unique to E-scan. It's any pre-laid out measuring system has the ability to acquire these data. And of course, we did it here as well. So when we went a bit deeper and looked, now we're looking at a plan view across here. We've got this very strong conductive body here, which is directly underlying the ore body. It's something going on, probably in the structure that rises from considerable depth and ended up with silica and gold precipitation at this level. So there it is, and the bad news was that this is not a easily detectable anomaly in this particular case, but the good news is that if you bother to go deeper, or if you're able to go deeper, here's a secondary aspect of the setting here, which is actually a really good geophysical target. This is 5 to 7 ohm meters as a vertical sheet, and about 100 feet thick. So it's a very strong EM conductor. And we could come back to the client and say, well, if this is typical of district mineralization setting, which is what they were suggesting, we could go look for these things in the remaining 150 square miles of the district. But in reality, what we've done here is just proven up that the K2 management should be calling Jean Legault here and covering the area with a VTEM survey. You know, who needs this kind of complication? If that's going to be the marker for mineralization in that area, well, give it a shot. Nuance machine, whatever. You can learn stuff about an area that maybe puts yourself out of business for that district. The client's sure happy, and if it's there, that's great news. Just for fun, we know what's going on with this stuff. Here's a line, maybe these are CSMT conductors or resistors or DC resistivity, IP, whatever. You don't know what's going on there. If you put that data into an inversion it's gonna guess, it's gonna see how it's gonna connect up, it's gonna get a good fit to the data. You don't really have any way of evaluating what's going on there, apart from knowledge of what the data set was that you supplied. If you know that the data set was extremist, you know that there's an endless number of possible models that can be generated, so you have to treat the end result model with great caution. A little more data, now the inversion knows what to do. You know what to do, you've already got it figured out, the inversion's gonna figure it out, because you've supplied the answers that it needs in order to solve the questions that it's continuously asking itself as it refers to the data and builds the model. So when you're looking for objectivity, it's all about the data. So on the left, we saw this in Josh's talk earlier, and it was taken from that same slide series. This gives the inversion a chance to just work away and look up the answers to every question it has in terms of developing a 3D model. If this is your data set here, you need to know that that's your data set. So when you look at the model, the 3D model after processing, it'll look just as competent, just as geologically detailed looking as the model that comes from this data set. But you know there's some lack of information in some directions. Here it would be better coupling with certain structures than others, and the inversion is being asked basically to fill in the gaps. So if you don't leave any gaps, you have a better chance of an objective model. That's going to be important when we get to this point, because we're going to look at subtle features in here that we have to count on not being artifacts or basically functions of a biased or incomplete data set. But we'll go back to New Zealand here, and I've just put a sort of a simulated 100-meter penetration survey across a 3-mile stretch here, and we've got a couple of resistive anomalies, background conductivity in between, and this would actually correspond with those outcropping grassy cinder hot spring cinders that we saw in the opening slide. One here and one here. And logically, you look at those things, you're out there sampling and getting some assays done, and you're going to treat them as separate systems unless you have some reason to think that they might be connected. So if in the course of doing your exploration to, let's say, a depth of realistically 200 or 300 meters in an area, which is what we were doing in that particular case, if you're doing the overview scale survey, which happens pretty much automatically with the e-scan or with the distributed acquisition systems, this is what you're going to see. It's the big picture. Suddenly you have to explain this connection between these two outcropping areas. There's a secondary connection over here as well. Now, we're talking about the data that you're using for the inversion. If you look at something like this, we've all seen sections like this coming out of inversions, but we don't often have any information as to what the reliability is here. Now, if we compute the sensitivity of the model in terms of the supplied data, we can put that line on there and say that this is the limit, or this is the limit. Everything else below is sort of extrapolated and manufactured by the inversion in the course of completing its job. So in a situation like this, we want to know that particular line of demarcation is at least here and maybe down here. The data set in this area, measured data, is down around here, and computations that have verified that this bottom edge of this particular model element is actually very firmly embedded in the supply of data. This is not, there's no presumptions, this does cut off. So we're now looking at something that we have to explain, or we have the opportunity to explain. And this certainly looks like we've got a situation where a single upwelling source of fluids has come up, and we can do a little bit of visual cartoon work here and imagine this this conduit, maybe fault structures or something, bringing these fluids up. They're cooling a little bit, they're beginning to depressurize, they're starting to precipitate silica. As they rise, silica is being precipitated, it's basically capping itself, sealing itself off. So we've got an area here that's basically constraining the upward flow. The fluids are backing up in here and eventually find their way off to the side and vent at surface. So that's a legitimate hydrothermal thought process, seems to fit. We have a lot of confidence in this particular image and in all the details, so there you go. With just that, we're going to be hopefully finding some sort of a feeder down here, looking for it at least. You do your best, you might not come up with anything. Here's where you actually ought to be drilling, according to this cartoon. And here's the upwelling flow area, lateral flow at this side. That's a big task. We're talking about 2 kilometer holes. You'd have to be really convinced that this was going to be something special, maybe even a Hishik area equivalent or something like that to justify that. But deeper holes have been drilled for sure. There's the sort of thing that we're trying to solve. And we've got that imagery underneath that invites you to connect two of those hot spring cinder areas. That's a lot of information. And speaking of a lot of information, if you look at the details here, look at that topographic high there, corresponding with a little subtle resistive high. Another little bit of detail in here where there's a little bump in the resistivity. That's particularly close to surface with wide spacing surveys, wide survey spacing. You have to be a little bit careful with that sort of stuff, but I don't personally give a lot of stock to that, but it is a little bit of correlation. These are definitely those knobs that are sticking up there. And presumably when the fluids are rising up here and beginning to precipitate, you're going to have gases escaping here, and the lower resistivity in this area, you'd expect to see some sort of alteration that you could perhaps identify with the process of rising hydrothermal fluid. So you can do a lot of work right on the surface to evaluate the pattern. We've developed some thoughts. This is the way we refer to 3D data sets in-house these days. We've assigned the term true 3D to field data set that's uniformly all directional and uniformly distributed both laterally and to depth. If you want to have the objectivity to compare one part to another, this subtlety to that subtlety, you need uniformity, even if it means dropping some of the data out of the convergent data set. So you've got extra density over here. Decimate it to the point that it's all equal, and then you have an equally weighted model to deal with. The big distinction here is that not every target commodity needs the same intensity of survey work. If you're going after a large-scale conductive body, a much lower density of uniformly distributed 3D data will do the job. You can save some money, get a good job done. At the other end of the spectrum, when we get into resistive bodies,
we need a higher density of sampling. We're looking at perhaps subtle features. Resistive features themselves are harder to constrain than a conductive body. So full spectrum 3D basically is just a true 3D on steroids, I guess, a lot higher density of sampling. Just to recap on this stuff, hole by hole property limits, data plotted according to the nominal depth of investigation. Not going to be an FS3D, true 3D data set at all in terms of objectivity for all directions. And there's the sort of depth expectation for the hole by hole array. Here's the E-scan in the same area, and the NUDAS and the Orion's going to be the same. We've got all directional data in this main cone area. Towards the edges, the data tend to be parallel to the edges of the property, so as you get deeper, your area of true all-directional objectivity is pinching in a little bit. Now this is pole-pole data. If you're using pole-bipole data, it's going to pinch in a little bit more because the pole-bipole data basically take more real estate on the surface for a given unit of penetration. All other arguments aside, that's just the normal depth of investigation value speaking. So if we recall in Josh's paper about how we were getting deep information at Comstock, this is what it looks like. If this was 600 meters across, we were getting data down in the 300 meter depth of investigation. We cut our model off closer to 200 meters, but we still had lots of data observations underneath that to make sure that features at the lower edge of our model were properly constrained. Now, that's all nice to have those cartoons and so on, but let's get real here and let's see where is actually able to be demonstrated in terms of the pull-off fully developed situation. Most of you are familiar with the Hollister area at the north end of the Carlin Trend. This is the Hatter Stock. We're talking about 3 miles by 2 miles here. E-scan survey done between 1990 and 2002 in three phases. First phase in this area. This is the Guinevere and Clementine vein systems, close to 9.5 ounces of gold in place right now. Elevated resistivity, not surprising, quartz association. In this area, there's hot spring sinters, terraces, and so on. Up here in the Velvet, Butte mining areas, more sinters, mercury mines, all the good signs of potential epithermal gold mineralization. We'll look at four sections across the 3D model here and just see what we see. And just a reminder, that's what we were looking at in New Zealand. We're going to bring that down from a very large scale to something a lot smaller, but everything else is equal. The pattern is still speaking to us when we get to a Hollister. And here we are. This is the U-shaped pattern repeated here, a long stripe. The white marker here is the interface between the tertiary volcanics and the Ordovician basement. You can see it in the geologic section of the side as well. A little bit of disseminated gold in the near surface in the volcanics here. But this is basically the same pattern that we saw in the New Zealand results. And if you saw that pattern coming up without the actual mineralized basement structures in place, I'm suggesting that you should be thinking in terms of that particular hydrologic model, that something to cause a shape like that in an otherwise normally layered regime that needs an explanation. And the idea of rising fluids, self-capping, escaping off the ends and coming to surface to prevent is a good one. Not everyone is going to, not every occurrence of a deep feeder is going to happen this way. Some of them will make it straight up to surface and do their thing. And that won't look like this. So it won't be, I mean, it's the pattern talking to you. It's not you having expectations or letting the 3D details guide you along. There's a blow up of one of the sections. You can see in the early days, the white lines are rotary percussion holes that mostly stopped at the basement, and they were interested in this disseminated gold halo here. Eventually, when people found the money, got serious, and started really thinking about this, in particular, in the absence of finding any major structures underneath the cinder outcropping areas, which are here and here, and again further over. Big surprise. When eventually they got their stuff together, put a hole in like that down into the basement. Here's the contact, the interface between the volcanics and the basement. Then they were cutting across the feeder structures, and bingo, there's the high grade underneath the disseminated surface. So that's what we would expect you might have in New Zealand. Of course, whether there's any gold there, or you just run into barren silica, that's the look of the draw, that's the exploration process. But at least you know, generally, you're inferring where the structure might be, not under the actual surface expressions, but because you've got this pattern in three dimensions, you're saying, okay, probably a common feeder in this case. This is suggesting that these ones are pretty major, given that they're centered on this thing, but they're not necessarily the same as these ones over here. There could be a number of pulses separated by a considerable amount of time. One pulse may not have been carrying gold for some reason. Who knows? This is all the exploration stuff. But all we're saying here is that when you see a pattern like this, drill underneath it, across, try and figure out what azimuth to use, what sort of structural controls might be there, so that we can drill across the structure. So what about the stuff to the right? We looked at those long sections, and here's the rest of these patterns. And if you've got 1.5 million ounces over here, and you've got this pattern over here, also with sinters at surface, also with mercury workings and all the same signs of historic production and so on, as you had over here, what are you going to do? I think you're going to drill it. Politics and money and all that stuff gets in the way sometimes, so it really hasn't been looked at very closely yet, but here's another possible pattern in here that you're going to propose as a possibility and get into the full 3D stuff. In isosurface renderings, this kind of stuff would really jump off the page if you're looking at the U-shaped long structure down here, elongate to the east-west. This one here, though, is more circular. We'll look at a section that goes across this way and give us the other dimension on it. We're facing west here now. When we're facing north, this is it. This is up at the Butte thing. It looks identical facing north, so it's basically circular, cup-shaped. You're going to have to deal with drilling under that, possibly more than just a couple of holes. Right. This one at the bottom here with the elongate faults, easier to decide how to drill that, because if you got some length to the anomaly, clearly you want to be going across because you're expecting a sheet-like or linear fault system. So there's the pattern in a dynamic sense, and a real prospect.
If we look in plan view at the surface, the linear resistive zones here that we saw the sections through, corresponding with the centers, up here we've got a circular pattern, and some of that corresponds with centers as well. In between, perhaps another circular pattern here, maybe some linear elements. Over here, we've got a circular, a larger scale circular feature lying on strike with these faults. We've got linears up here that we need to understand. And over here is the Hatter stock, which has its own bit of a ring, bit of a stretch. But the thing is, when you have the 3D information, you want to be looking at these details with different models in mind. And then when you look deeper, you're looking for that blockage, that self-sealing cap to be in place that caused the fluids to be pushed out to the sides and come up in either the parallel lines, in this case, or the circular pattern up here. And here it is. We've already seen that in the sections. This is where the blockage is. The fluids leaks up on all the sides in order to reach surface here. So in here, you might expect to find some effective alteration from the escape of gases early in the process, like more conductive than other areas. But, you know, watch that thing as we go down. There's the base of the cup, as it were. Here's the same thing here. And here, where we have that ring of shallow resistivity, here's the base of this particular thing. So this is looking like a mega version of this one. It's right on strike with this stuff here. You want to get some holes into that guy for sure. Up here, where we saw a bunch of linears out here, not much happening. Not the same pattern as this, so that's a whole different thing to be looking at. Maybe those features have straight up pipes underneath. There was no deflection. Things reach the surface directly, and you'll treat them in that way if you're wanting to look deeper. So, to get close to the end, yeah, we've seen the idea laterally that we can look for the enclosing alteration envelope, and we've seen at depth the whole idea of this kind of a pattern showing up. And once you start thinking about this stuff and you've got the data sets to look at, Newman's going to have a ton of these data sets that maybe you've already got this stuff figured out, maybe not, but here's Hasbrook Peak, which is a nice resistive anomaly in a typically 20 to 30 ohm-meter background. Another survey done in 1995 here, which has some lookalike material here. A nice northwest trend coming through. But over here, this was just dismissed. It wasn't anywhere near this strength, and it just was a zone. It just seemed to be an area that was going to go forever. You know, I'm interested in that. It's just a different degree of weathering or a different rock type. But when we played around with the color scaling a little bit, 160 ohm meters and a 35 ohm meter background, that's a legitimate anomaly, probably indicating silicification, and we see the details of possible escape of fluids to surface. So your notes consist of get out there and look for some evidence of that, see if there's some signs of alteration, silicification at surface. This could be a different sort of a situation right next door to this very low grade, top of the mountain thing, where you basically just push it all down the hill and mill it. Not too far away here, 2 miles away, is the potential for a deep feeder structure with high grade, if there's not some grades in here or above as well. So the point is that when you're collecting these data, there might be an awful lot that doesn't meet the eye initially, especially if you're focused on what you were hired to find, and that is, say, a lookalike for this. We focused on that and didn't really look at that enough. That's not going to happen again. And once again, as an isosurface 3D rotate with music, these kind of things are going to be very compelling, and it's going to be pretty irresistible in terms of being able to resist that building that sort of a feature. So that's, I think that's it. Yeah, just a reminder, a lot of what we're talking about here presumes absolute objectivity, so you can deal with these subtleties. You saw how subtle that last one was, and that's it.
Further questions?
There's not one in the agenda, but I'm going to ask you this resolution you're getting. Are you seeing any interest, say, like in a Mount Holly situation where they had a breach of their tailings dam? It seemed to me your sort of technology would be very effective in that sort of role. I apologize, it's not quite on topic, but you're mapping resistivities, and I think you know a little bit about that, where apparently they put up their tailings dam on top of very sludgy, lacustrine material, and that's what popped out, the result of the breach there. Are you seeing any interest from the community in using these in that sort of situation, given the quality and the fact you've been doing this since 1982?
We have. We've seen a lot of diverse attention. That's a circumstance where you could analyze the ground conditions initially and maybe get some ideas. You could also get involved in a permanent monitoring installation. And we've been asked to do things in that direction a couple of times. One to do with continuous electrical monitoring of dikes and levees, early warning system where you're seeing increased conductivity due to the water penetration beyond the surface aquifer, setting up with earthen dam structures, large-scale hydroelectric dam structures, even continuous 3D imaging, again to identify destabilizing water intrusion. And the biggest one of all, the Atomic Energy Commission in Washington announced put together a proposal, 20 years ago, for a permanent e-scan installation around Yucca Mountain, which would be coupled with MT. E-scan would be dealing with the first couple of miles, MT going down from there, 100-year installation, setting diurnal and yearly signature cycles and looking for long-term advance warning of, say, increased temperatures at depth that might be a precursor to volcanic activity or something like that. Almost limitless, basically, the concepts that you can address with this. And the scaling. Obviously to be able to scale it up and down. Any other questions, or did I do it? No?
Yeah, well, nice talk. Nice talk, Greg. It's nice to see you present your life's work. I mean, Greg is a pioneer in 3D IP, and we had a 3D IP session at the SEG last year, and Greg unfortunately wasn't able to attend. And I think the geophysical community was missed because they're so glad. Now, getting to my question, I know the title of your talk was 3D resistivity, but my first question is, did you collect, what is the IP with that? And if you collected any IP in hearing, and how diagnostic was it of the type of systems that you were looking at? Was it in terms of like a comparison to the Mississippi?
I'm so glad you asked. We have two poster sections that will be up for duration. And Hasbro is one of them, and it concludes the IP. And the 3D IP shot in 1989, I guess it was. It's irrelevant there. It's background, a little bit of variation, no correlation with the mineralization. Suppressed of anything as you get away from this kind of area, as you might expect. The level comes up a little bit, but it still stays in background, 1.5%. In other cases, Comstock, the IP is playing a really big role there. And that's our thinking is that when you go into a new area and don't really know what's going on, if you're going to be truly objective, heck, you want to do the IP, at least on the first one, until the data say, don't bother. It's more expensive to do. It doesn't happen automatically for E-scan as it does with new DAS. We have to stack longer, so it takes a little longer to get it possible, but more than processing is no big deal. But we did ratios, the old metal factor concept of IP we normalized for resistive before Comstock, and we found that that was giving us some highlights to explore in a way, which is the main purpose of simplistic ratio like that. Come to the poster sessions, because some of what you saw here you get a chance to study in a little more detail, but there's other stuff going on there as well. So it'll be a great chance for one-on-one questions about all of this stuff. I realize it's a ton of material. Okay. Anything else? Okay.
Thank you, Greg.